morning all. So today we are going to discuss the next topic. In the previous topic that we actually discussed about the characteristic of the tires. So in this lecture we are going to discuss about the tire coordinate system, then the effect of braking and the acceleration, and the last one is the Gough tire characteristic. So coming to the first topic, that is the tire coordinate system. Tire coordinate system basically representing, or it is also known as a psi coordinate system for the tire. So we already discussed this thing previously in the previous unit. That means there is a three axes are there, as well as on these three axes basically three movements as well as three forces are there. So you can see this is the direction of heading, we can say. That means there is a forward direction here, that is a backward direction here. This is representing the lateral direction, where the lateral force Fy basically acting. There is a movement My will be there, and again there is one more lateral direction will be there. It is also known as a downward direction, that is Fz. So as per the psi convention, we already know forward we take positive, backward we take negative, and right side we take positive, left side we take negative, and downside we take positive, and upside we take negative. So this is the same sign convention basically we considered here as for the tire coordinate system. Same case we can also say that it is also known as a vehicle coordinate system. So the two angles we are able to see here, that is the alpha and the gamma. Alpha you already know, that is the slip angle. So slip angle considered right side positive, left side we considered the negative. That means this is the velocity vector and this is the actual plane. So this angle basically considered the slip angle, and this is representing the camber angle, that is represented by a symbol gamma. So when we talking about the tire coordinate system, the few terminologies very common here. So these are the terminologies that you have to considered while designing a tire, or while understanding the concepts related to the tire. So as you consider the same figures, same thing has to be considered. Like the first thing it is representing is the wheel plane. Wheel plane basically where the plane is actually intersecting at the center. So that is representing a wheel plane. Wheel center basically representing the center at where the axis of spin will be passed. So that is representing the wheel center. Next one is the center of tire contact. Center of tire contact basically representing, if we projecting the spin axis that passing to the center at the ground, that representing the center of tire contact. So that is representing the new term, that is the intersection of the wheel plane and the projection of the spin axis onto the road plane. Next one is the loaded radius. Loaded radius basically representing here the actual distance from the center of tire contact to the center of the wheel. That is representing the actual loaded radius. Actual loaded radius means when the load has been considered in that situation, it is representing a loaded radius. And if the loaded will not be there, that will be considered as a unloaded radius condition. That means that is also known as a radius of the tire without considering any kind of load. So if we consider the loaded radius, that can be represented by a symbol RW. If we talking about the unloaded radius condition, that is actually considered as by the symbol RG. So two terms are there, RW and RG. So loaded means when the load has been considered over the wheels, due to that when some compression has been occurred at the downside, due to that compression the radius will not be a static, it is a dynamic in nature. So that radius basically considered as a loaded radius. Next one is the longitudinal force. That means at the forward direction, we already know the force we considered as a longitudinal, or the where the forward velocity will be there, where the traction force actually act. Next one is known as the lateral force. We already discussed this lateral force basically acting in the perpendicular to the direction of the motion. Fz basically representing the downward force, that means a normal force basically acting on the wheels due to the weight of the vehicle while running condition. And movement are there, the overturning movement about x-axis, rolling movement about y-axis, and the aligned movement about the z-axis. So all three movements is also acting. That means in total six components you have actually seen, three force components and three movement components are there. Then after slip angle, you already know the angle between the heading direction and the travel direction. Camber angle basically representing angle between the wheel plane and the wheel, actual wheel and the wheel plane. That means that angle basically representing the camber angle. It can be positive, it can be negative, it can be neutral. That means if the wheel is actually moving in the outward direction, we consider as a positive. But if it is an inward direction, we consider a negative. As it is a, generally it's a straight wheel, that we consider as a neutral. That means the camber angle will be a zero. Now the next topic here, we are talking about the effect of driving as well as a braking torque. So when we are talking about the effect of driving and the braking torque, so very common term here we are talking about the loading condition. So when the load has been applied, or we can say when the brake has been applied, in that situation the force at the contact patch front side will be higher as compared to the rear side contact patch. So in that situation, so slip ratio has to be generated. So what is the slip ratio? So again, if we talking about the slip ratio, there's a two types of slip ratio has to be generated here. One slip ratio while considering for the braking one, and the second slip ratio we can say it is for the driving purpose. That means for the driving torque as well as for the braking torque. Generally, we considered driving torque as a positive slip ratio or positive slip angle, and negative basically we considered as a for the braking torque. So you can see the longitudinal slip ratio for the tire, it is actually given in this formula. It is actually represented by a symbol S. That means it is a ratio. It is the RG WW upon VX minus 1. What is this RG WW? It is representing the velocity. Omega representing the spin velocity, that means angular velocity. RG representing the radius of unloaded condition. That means a turn, that is the radius of the tire during the unloading condition. That means the geometry of the tire at the unloaded condition. Vx representing the forward velocity here, minus 1. So this will give you the longitudinal slip ratio. So here we consider a one force that is known as the friction force. So how to represent the friction force? We generally know the force we consider that is represented by symbol Fx. It will also equals to the friction force when the system should be in equilibrium condition. So how to write the friction force? The friction force can also be written as mu r or mu f. We can say the same thing has been written here. Fx equals to mu f s then fz. So here this mu is the function of friction. That means it is also known as coefficient of the friction. That's why it is also a function of S. S representing the slip ratio. So here we can also say the longitudinal friction coefficient is also a function of the slip ratio. So same slip ratio has to be considered. I'll go through the same figure later on. First we'll discuss the concept. So when we talking about the coefficient of friction, the two types of coefficient of friction here we talking about. First one is known as the peak coefficient of friction. Second one is the steady state coefficient of friction. If you're talking about the peak coefficient of friction, that can be represented by a symbol mu dp. And the second one, the steady state coefficient of friction, that can be represented by a symbol mu ds. So peak basically representing where the alteration of the slip ratio will be higher, then it becomes a steady state. That means if you see this figure now, so this is representing while driving the slip ratio will be positive, and while braking slip ratio will be negative in nature. That means if we're talking about the same formula for the braking, it will be one minus the same thing. That means right now it is written S is equals to R omega upon Vx minus 1. That is for the driving purpose. Same case I can also written for the braking purpose. In the braking purpose, that becomes one minus overall thing. So you are able to see two things. The two that means the horizontal axis representing for the driving as well as the braking side. Driving representing a positive direction, braking representing a negative direction. And this vertical axis basically representing the coefficient of friction. That means this is a function here with respect to S. So here two coefficients we are able to see here. First one for the peak one, second one for the steady one. That means if you see, this coefficient of friction actually plays an important role while calculating the slip ratio. It starts from zero. That means when the vehicle at this static condition. In that situation, when the vehicle start driving, that means you are giving an acceleration. In that situation, that coefficient of friction becomes very higher, or we can say it becomes a very in peak value or the maximum value. Then after, when the distance has been traveled, it becomes a steady state in that situation. So this is representing during the sliding condition and during the peak condition. So that's during the sliding condition that becomes a steady state. Same manner while braking, there is a one situation has been occurred where the brakes becomes very peak, then after it becomes slow and again it becomes a very constant, or we can say it is in a steady state manner. So same thing has been representing here. As like in this line it is written there, mu is the function of the slip ratio. Now here we can also say the coefficient of friction is proportional to the slip ratio. If you remove the proportional symbol, there is a one constant which actually came up, that is known as CS. CS is nothing, it is a constant. So we can say if the value of slip ratio is very very small, in that situation mu x will be almost near to the zero. So that basically we consider here. Now one more thing that is very important here, when we consider the same situation, So two things basically we consider here. First one is the distance it is freely used for the tire. Second one, the actual distance in that situation some friction basically will act. So two conditions basically we consider here. The tire actually start moving without any kind of frictional effect, that means that freely travel without any kind of slippage. Second, we consider the actual one where the slippage can be possible. So DA and DF you are able to see here, where DF basically representing it is a distance traveled by the tire freely without any kind of slippage, and DA representing the distance traveled by the tire which is actually actual in nature. That means in actual we can say there is a slippage will be there, but in DF we consider it is an ideal case, there is no slippage has been there. So generally if we talking about if is there any slipping has been occurred, that means DA should be higher than the DF. If there is a spinning will be there, then we can say DA should be lesser than DF. It means that if the tire start rolling freely in that situation, that means spinning is going on. So when we talking about a spinning, DF should be greater than DA. Or if we talking about the slipping will be there in that situation, DA should be greater than DF. So these two condition has to be considered here. So generally we came up with the difference of DF minus DA is representing the tire slip. So how to write a tire slip ratio, that means this is the proof you are talking about here that we initially discussed the formula. So this is representing the tire slip formula, that means this is the slip ratio can be written as the freely tire, that means the theoretical value minus actual value divided by the actual value. How to calculate the error percentage? Theoretical minus actual divided by actual, so that we actually calculating the difference in terms of actual manner. So this is representing the slip ratio. So same thing if you want to write infinite time, that means the time is very elementary in nature or very infinite in nature. In that situation I have considered in terms of df dash minus da dash upon da dash. So same thing you can see, there is a wheel, this is a forward direction, this is angular velocity omega, da is greater than df. So if we consider while spinning means DF should be greater than DA. If we talking about while slipping, then DA should be greater than DF. So we consider the same expression, that means DF minus DA upon DA. If it is coming negative, that means in that situation that is presenting for the braking one. If it is coming positive, that we talking about here for the driving one. Now what I did, now I putting the expression of DF minus DA upon DA. That means how to write, can we write in terms of this thing? We already know, can we write in terms of velocity? V minus the that is RG WW minus RW WW upon RW into WW. RG basically representing the tire radius without any kind of load. RW basically representing the tire radius during loading condition. That means this is the actual radius and this is without any kind of extra load, that is the radius. So this is the theoretical minus actual divided by the actual. So I can also written the same thing in terms of velocity. What is V is equals to V? Can we write V is equals to R omega? Same thing. That is the angular velocity. So I have written here, if you simplify this, that means what is common here in these three or in these two terms, that means at the numerator side and the denominator side, can we say omega W is common here as well as omega W is here? So when if we cut it down, what will be left? It will be left in the same manner, RG minus RW upon RW. So this will give you the expression here. So same thing, if we divide this denominator portion on both sides, that means if we separate the complete expression, can be written in this manner, this upon Vx minus 1. That becomes 1 and that becomes Vx. Vx is nothing, it is representing the forward velocity. These two terms are actually not same. RW into WW, that is representing the forward velocity, that is representing the unloaded radius into the angular velocity. So same, we actually proved that we actually seen initially in this expression. So this is the expression for the driving one. Same if you want to write for the braking torque, the formula becomes S is equals to 1 minus RG WW upon Vx. Only this is the difference, rest is the same. So now coming to the next one, how to identify the tire characteristic according to the Gough. So Gough is a scientist, they actually plotted a one graph. That graph is actually known as the Gough plots, or it is also known as a carpet plot. If you see the carpet plot, the horizontal axis basically representing the realignment torque, that is represented by symbol MR. So So this is the case study has been considered for the Michelin tire having some specific standard conditions they generally considered for generating a plot. So every tire at every condition at every speed the plot will be a different. So that means this is the standard one again we need to consider. So this is actually not a standard for all velocities as well as all inclination pressure at all tire specifications. So at different specification basically maybe we'll get a different plot, or it is also known as a carpet plot. So you can see here this is representing the realignment torque and the vertical axis basically representing the lateral force. Lateral force in generally we already discussed this in the last unit, that is represented by a symbol Fy also. Here they're using a term S. S is nothing, it is Fy, that means a lateral force, that is a realignment torque. Realignment torque means the torque that has actually acted at the Z axis. What we already discussed this, what is Mz? Mz is representing the alignment torque. So you can see alignment torque is the Mz and realignment is, that means we need to cope up with the same thing in a aligned direction, that means it is a realignment manner, that is representing a realignment torque. As well as you are able to, the slip angle is actually written there 2 degree, 4 degrees, 6, 8 and 12. So that means here it is actually considering what is the affected parameter for the single tire while a friction has been generated, or we can say while the tire actually having any kind of wear and tear. So what are the properties they consider? First of all, the what is the realignment torque while cornering, what is the lateral force actually acting, if we increase the lateral force what happen, if we increase the realignment torque what actually happened, how much wheel load will be there. Wheel load basically presenting what is the total load actually acting over the wheel. Suppose if it is a 50 kN what can be the situation and what can be the slip angle, if it is a 40, if it is a 30, if it is a 20. Same manner the caster, the distance will be actually given here. You can see they consider the complete plot with some specific standard conditions. Like suppose the condition first, they are actually assuming the dry road surface. Apart from dry road, the two other road can be considered like the wet road condition. Otherwise they can also consider the ice road, that means icy road, that means where the chances of frictional force will be very very lesser. At wet road the friction will be much higher as compared to the ice road, but in dry road frictional surface is very high as compared to the other. V naught representing the forward velocity, PI representing the inclination pressure inside the tire, and that is the tire characteristic that has been given. So this is the standard tire they considered and accordingly they plot that graph. That graph basically representing nothing, it is a carpet plot. It will give you the major information related to the tire, because due to frictional force how much wearing is going on, how much loading is going on, how much slip angle has been generated. So this is representing the tire characteristic as per the Gough. Now coming to the last topic of this unit, that means this is a numerical problem. So there is a question, 215/55R16. So what is this? This is a specification of the tire. It takes a 50 gram V's weight to balance assembly. What is the magnitude of the imbalance force without the weight at 100 km per hour? So this is the question has been given, that means the tire characteristic has been given, as well as there is a weight has been given, that means we can say the mass has been given in terms of 50 gram, and he actually gave the speed of 100 km per hour. He is asking how much magnitude of the force basically will act if it is actually moving at 100 km per hour. So how to calculate the same thing? First of all, we already know what is the tire characteristic. What is this 250? That is a section width, 55 representing the aspect ratio, R representing for the radial, and 16 representing the diameter of rim in inch. So 50 gram mass will be given, as well as 100 km per hour velocity will be given. So first of all, the first step, we need to calculate the diameter of the tire. So how to calculate the diameter of the tire? This expression has to be used. What is this expression? First of all, in diameter of tire, what is the total size of the tire? That means the total diameter. Suppose if this is a tire, I have suppose this is the tire basically I have, and this is the internal portion, that means this, suppose this is a rim basically we have. So this rim size is already given, that is a 16 inch. I need to calculate what is the total diameter of this tire. This one representing the height of the tire, this is also the height of the tire. So how to calculate how much the diameter of rim is given? 16. So this is 16, so I have converted the 16 inch into mm. So how to convert 25.4? I have multiplied with the factor just to convert from inch to mm, plus twice. What is this twice? Twice representing this h from here to here, as well as from here to here. At these two height, into what is this 205 into 55. So we already discussed 55, it is actually given as the aspect ratio. So how to write aspect ratio? Aspect ratio can be written as like this: A aspect ratio AR is equals to height to the weight. Aspect ratio can be written, it is a ratio of height to the weight in terms of percentage. If the aspect ratio is given 55%, if you remove a percentage symbol, how much it will be left? It will be left only 0.55 and 5. So this is the aspect ratio. Now how much width, section width has been given in the question? Section width, it is 215. So see this, this is section width has been given. So section width will be 215, so multiply 215 with this sum, you will get the height. So 215 into 0.55 into 2, this will give you the overall diameter of the tire. In terms of mm, it is 642.9, or we can also convert in terms of inches, 25.31 inch. Then after, we need to calculate the angular velocity. We already know how to calculate angular velocity. Omega is equals to V by R. So V, we already have in terms of kilometer per hour, so convert it in terms of meter per second. So how to convert this thing? Convert this kilometer into 1000, that divided by 3600. Simplify it, you will get this velocity. That is 27.78 meter per second. Then R, R is the same thing. This is the diameter divided by 2, this will give you the radius. Solve it, this will give you the angular velocity. It is coming 86.4 radian per second. Now what has been asked, he's asking calculate the magnitude of imbalance force. So how to calculate the imbalance force? So that means when, if there is an imbalance will be there, that means some external force actually acting in the outward direction. So that type of force basically known as a centrifugal force. So how to calculate a centrifugal force? Mr omega square. So mass is actually given in gram, so convert in kg, so it becomes 0.050 kg into R. Now this R is actually not same as like this R. This I am calculating the inertia force because I want to calculate what? The magnitude of the imbalance force actually acting on the rim. So this is representing the radius of the rim. What is the diameter of the rim? Diameter of the rim is already given 16. So radius becomes 8. So 8 into, again I have converted into mm, into omega square. To simplify this, the finally I got the answer that is representing 75.84 Newton. So this is the final answer that representing, this is the imbalance force has been created. If the vehicle start moving at a speed of 100 km per hour, having some imbalance force is 50 gram. So that's all. This topic ends unit number 5. From the next lecture, we will start the next unit, that is the unit number 6, that is the shear stress in beams and sections. So we will start it in the next. If you have any query related to the given content, so you can ask me over the LPO Live app. Thank you.